Are you satisfied with the German-British initiative?
We think it's a very good initiative. It's neither lowering the criteria for Bosnia-Herzegovina's accession process to the European Union, nor eliminating any of the criteria. But method-wise, it's rearranging the sequence of steps. And I think it suggests a much more efficient approach to actually achieving all the benchmarks and fulfilling all the criteria, rather than just saying the country is not meeting the standards and not achieving the benchmarks and therefore nothing. And repeating the same thing every year, nothing is changing. On the contrary, staying in one place in this case, I think, equals sliding backwards. I think it's absolutely in everybody's interest that Bosnia-Herzegovina actually meets those criteria. And in order to do that, European Union needs to take a more hands-on, proactive approach. And I think this initiative is going in that direction.
This is a significant change with in the EU with regard to Bosnia and Herzegovina. What led to this change?
I didn't understand what.
What were the conditions that led to such a
change? What led
in position?
To the change? On one level, the citizens of Bosnia Herzegovina, if I may say so. Who showed their dissatisfaction. There were all kinds of other things part of those events in Bosnia-Herzegovina, but a big part was people showing their frustration with sort of a stalemate, difficult economic conditions. And they sort of went out into the street and voiced it. I think everybody decided that maybe it's time to sort of rethink the approach. This was early this year. Croatia at that time, being a country, a member of the European Union, but with over 1,000 kilometers border with Bosnia-Herzegovina, produced two non-papers, which we distributed among all of my colleagues, foreign ministers of the countries of the European Union, suggesting precisely what I mentioned earlier, keeping the existing high criteria for Bosnia-Herzegovina, but trying to think of a different way of helping the country meet those criteria. And at that time, there was a positive reaction on the Foreign Affairs Council and conclusions of the Foreign Affairs Council that took that into account. But this was far from actually taking up this new approach. At that time, we all agreed that maybe the time right after the elections in Bosnia-Herzegovina would be a good time, and that time is now. Mm-hmm. And this British-German initiative, I think, takes into account a number of suggestions that we made earlier this year, but at this, I think, very appropriate time. And we still need to transform this into a European Union initiative or new policy. But I think we are on the right track in that direction. Absolutely everybody realized that we need something that's more effective. Mm-hmm. Not different standards, not different criteria, not different benchmarks, but more effective approach.
As far as I understand, the German-British initiative proposes a new strategy. Who's going to write the strategy? The Commission, upon a request of the Council, or the Council, a working group, or what?
Certainly the council, well, the Foreign Affairs Council will agree on that strategy. It is something that in my opinion, needs to be discussed also with Bosnia and Herzegovinian elected authorities, since the first sort of step in this new strategy envisions written commitment by Bosnia and Herzegovinian leading political figures and leadership to implement the set of reforms that then will follow. I think that maybe the best way of doing that would be to make this part or one section of the program of the new government of Bosnia and Herzegovina that would then be voted on in Bosnia and Herzegovinian parliament, and this would make this into a really strong all-around commitment, including a written, but even more than a written commitment. All the necessary reforms and sequence and benchmarks for different stages, because stages, as far as Bosnia-Herzegovina goes, include written commitment, which I think would be the best way to do that, would be the government program. Opening of the or activating of the stabilization and association agreement, applying for membership, getting a positive AVI, and then finally getting the membership, the candidate status for
Bosnia. So something like a reward at every step.
It's the classical approach, certain requirements in order to qualify. This is not the reward. This is simply acknowledging that the country has met certain standards and certain criteria.
It is going to be something like...
The question is, excuse me, but the question is that now we need to define exactly in each stage what would be the required reforms.
Like a roadmap.
Exactly.
Is it something similar to the high-level dialogue that was launched by the previous commission?
This is something that's, I would say, more hands-on and more practical and more implementation-oriented.
Okay. Do you think the current geopolitical situation played a role in realizing, in EU realizing that it's time to, like you say, hands-on the European integration process of Bosnia and Herzegovina?
This is a very common assumption, and maybe it is true, but my experience is that it was actually not easy to keep Bosnia and Herzegovina on the agenda in competition with huge crisis issues such as Ukraine, such as the southern Mediterranean, such as Iraq, such as Syria. In comparison with those, Bosnia-Herzegovina looked like something that's not so urgent, and maybe we shouldn't focus so much on Bosnia-Herzegovina. So I'm not sure that the crisis in the European-Russian relations refocused the attention on Bosnia-Herzegovina, but when you think of that element too, it certainly is an important factor.
Do you think this new approach would mitigate the calls for reopening of the Dayton Peace Agreement?
I think we need to go one step at a time. Judging from our own experience, one of the few things that's absolutely needed, or if I may, I will correct myself, one of the many things that's absolutely needed for a successful accession process to the European Union is to have not only political elites, but the entire society on board. People have to support that. So nobody should feel or be in a position to feel threatened by the process. I think we need to move process forward. It brings certain changes in a way as a logical consequence of the reforms that you need for getting closer to candidate status. How that will then influence the decision making and the makeup of Bosnia-Herzegovina, I think we can leave for a later stage to see in what respect that is then affected.
In order for such a strategy to be successful and to deliver results, probably all the regional players need to be on board. Do you believe that Serbia will come on board?
Serbia is on board. From what I've heard from the foreign minister Dačić in Berlin, Serbia supports this process.
Okay, so in this regard, how do you see the return of Vojislav Seselj to Serbia? Could he pose a risk to any of the European integration processes in the region?
I must say I wouldn't like to be in the shoes of Serbian leadership at the moment. He is a huge embarrassment and a huge, how can I say, inconvenience for them. This is a person that, with all due respect to the legal process and due process, and only the court can bring the final verdict in this case, but in this particular case I think it's even obvious and in plain sight that he is a war criminal. And to have him after this many years in being outside of the Serbian society, have him back and have to deal with him and have to deal with the rhetoric that's completely unacceptable, but I think also in Serbia nowadays, completely unacceptable. Nobody knows what to do. And I don't think this will influence politics in Serbia, let alone in the region. But it is a pain. I understand them. I mean, for them, it's a problem, because they have this person running around saying completely outrageous things that they somehow have to deal with.
There were some calls, including from the Croatian government, for a tougher stance towards Serbia because of Seselj's return. And there was even talk about blocking Serbia's EU accession until some bilateral issues are resolved. Do you agree with such position?
Bilateral issues are bilateral issues. We said, we signed, not only signed, but voted on the so-called declaration on European accession, that we will not act in the same way in which some other countries acted when Croatia was entering the European Union, blocking them because they wanted to resolve some bilateral issues. We will just insist on something that's, I think, completely on which everybody else will insist, because this is a sort of self-understood within this process. And this is that the same standards and same criteria are used for everybody. So the same criteria that were used for Croatia, or that were used before that for the other East European countries, are used for all the other members. We will not use that to either force or resolve some issues that have nothing to do with the European Union, only the ones that have to do with meeting the standards. The ones that are our bilateral issues, we are completely capable of resolving bilaterally. And as far as Seselj is concerned, it wasn't up to Serbia that he was let out of prison. And I would, my only reaction to Serbia as far as Seselj is concerned is my condolences. I certainly wouldn't like to be in their shoes and have that type of person running around in my country or in anybody else's country. I mean, it's certainly not good.
Do you think all the hostilities from the past are already in the past here in the region, and there are no more risks for the stability of the region?
I don't think there is such a thing as long-term or forever resolved the issue of stability. I think you have to work on that permanently. I think neglecting some of the sensitive historical points, relations is politically responsible. I think we have to work on that. We have to try to resolve as many issues as we can, and also build foundations that would guarantee security and stability long term. But the moment you stop leading a proactive policy there, that is the moment when you're risking losing it.
And last thing, I know that Macedonia is a very different case than Bosnia and Herzegovina, but if everything goes on well with a new strategy and the new approach, then Macedonia will remain the only very specific and difficult case here in the Balkans. Do you think that something should be done about Macedonia as well?
To paraphrase my German colleague from what he said the other day in at our Aspen Institute conference in Berlin, something is being done. Not necessarily publicly, but there are political discussions, negotiations, and as he said, they're working also on the case of Macedonia. And I definitely hope that this will work out and there will be a solution found in which Macedonia can make progress.
So we can expect some news from about Macedonia as well soon?
I certainly hope so. I'm quoting or paraphrasing here, but from somebody who should know.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.